Clouds are so 2011.
I'm going to type FAB, puppet, conf, 2011, oh, caps lock.
Let's wait till it's running. Okay, let's continue. Now, I started the installation. I want to do some other boring part, terminology. The words I'm going to use in this talk. The first one is Overlord. It's the name I gave to the system which controls everything. Overlords can create overlords. It's pretty magic. Minion. What's an overlord without minions? So that's the systems which will be deployed by the overlord. Seed files. The Debian installer is based on seed files. You pre-seed the questions. It's the key of Seedbank. Fabric. It's a tool we use for infrastructure anywhere. It's a deployment tool in Python. Actually we use it for Bash in Python. Nice thing, it's made for deployment software. To deploy software, I deploy infrastructures with it. Infrastructure anywhere, there will be enough about it. The core, we have the FEB file. Not enough power. The FEB file in Fabric that controls everything. Every Fabric script you write, you run the FEB command, and that command will be read. Then I created a chicken script, chicken egg story. I don't know which is first. The chicken creates the Debian ISO, or downloads just a plain Debian ISO. It adds a seed file, it adds a simple directory overlay with, for example, SSH keys. Then the Debian ISO, continue that later. Then we have a simple PowerDNS script, DNS mask script to configure DNS and TFTP and DHCP, and then the backend is currently libvirt, and that controls the virtual machines. I will open source this. We have more backends. I won't open source those because they're still really ugly, but we can also deploy this on hardware. We can deploy this in the Amazon cloud or whatever. Again, the Debian ISO. It will download the Debian ISO, it will create the overlay directory, it will add the RC local file, which will execute Puppet. It adds the seed file, it adds the SSH key, and it adds the copy of our Puppet repository. It processes it to an ISO, that's what you've seen in the demo. And from there, we can create the overlord. As soon as we have the overlord, we can copy itself, and we can create minions. If we have the overlord, it's the key to everything. It's running Seedbank, it's the gateway to your cloud, to your whatever. It has all the tools needed to deploy all the infrastructures everywhere, and it can copy itself. One of the key things, or the anywhere in the infrastructure, anywhere, it's used, we invented a zone location system in Puppet. It's the only facts, the only custom facts we allow Puppet code to be based on. Or how do you say that? Let's explain it properly. Let's start again. We have the overlord. We have .a.c.m.e. The secret is A. It's the zone. For example, web server front end, or give it a short name. Then we have the location. We have quite a few data centers. We use it for the data center name. On my laptop, it's the domain is ECMI. The only differences we have between a production environment, a cloud environment, or my laptop are those files generated or read by the zone location. So we currently use XLOOKUP files for it. We should switch to the external node classifier, but with power comes responsibility. And the XLOOKUP files is sufficient for the current usage. So again, the difference between the production environment on my laptop is just a small CSV file. Everything else is the same. Questions about this? Let's go on. Seedbank, it's one of my children. I've been thinking about 6 years about a tool. 2 years ago, I started writing it. It had its ups and downs. It's open source by today. I put it online half an hour ago. It's a simple tool which allows to template Debian installs. There's lots of features. The core feature, and that's what Luke said in Ski Talk, simplicity. The only command, or in the whole infrastructure anywhere, it's just one command, the seedbank command, to roll out your Debian machines automated. It exists of three components, seedbank setup. So when you download seedbank, you need to have the netboot files, it will do it automatically. It has the seedbank main tool, which will generate the Pixie Linux config files. And it has the seedbank daemon, which will use the templates to generate seed files for the machine you want to roll out. Can we give it one more try? No. It starts with a minion, or we have a minion. It boots from the network, then the Debian installer starts. That's how it normally goes. If you add seedbank to this, the Debian installer connects to the seedbank daemon. The seedbank daemon looks in the pixie-linux.config directory. It will read out the pixie-linux file. And this is one of the core design decisions. There's no database backend. I just use comments in the pixie-linux.config file for what recipe to use, what Puppet manifest, what overlay, which overlay directory, and which templates. Then it generates the seed file on the fly, goes back to the Debian installer, and then you can automate installations. If people are interested in seedbank, and I hope not everybody's running Red Hat here, it's 10 steps. Configure DNS, DHCP, TFTP, download seedbank, install seedbank, configure the settings. There are lots of settings, but probably to start you only have to change two IP addresses. Restart the seedbank daemon, run the seedbank setup command to download your netboot files, and run seedbank and reboot your machine. This is the command, or this is the main seedbank command. I will explain. Seedbank, the main command, minus capital M means boot from MAC address. It has support for CMDB lookups. It has support to boot by hostname, and it could even boot by UUIDs from the system. Min O is the overlay directory. Keep it simple. I only use it for my SSH key, and I use it for my default Puppet configuration, otherwise a new machine will never know who's his daddy. Minus R is for the recipes. I designed it to use it for disk recipes, but it's nothing more than a snippet of a seed file, so you could use it for other options if you want. Minus M is the manifest option. These are actually Puppet manifest, which will run without a Puppet server. And then we have the host name, and we have the distribution, the release. In this example, Ubuntu Netty, and this is exactly what I use to roll out my laptop. Questions? I go way too fast. No questions? Okay, if that's the case, I'm gonna skip the showtime. I need to talk more before it's finished. So let's talk about structuring Puppet. I think everybody who has used Puppet for more than 3 months, and especially with more than two people, faced the dangers of Puppet and found out, it looks so nice, but I created this Apache module. I go on vacation, my colleague's gonna touch the Apache module because he wants some changes, you come back and everything is broken. Imagine we have about, at that when I started doing the design, we had about 20 people working in Puppet. So every 2 weeks, somebody else screwed up your code. I really didn't like it, so I've been thinking hard. Theo explained me once from Puppet Labs, you could use multiple module paths. That's the key of my structure. This Puppet structure is also the key of automated infrastructures. I think clouds are already 7 years deprecated, because when you automate your infrastructure properly, you could use it everywhere. With the cloud, it's too complex. You have lots of tools around it. With automated infrastructure, I use the same code base on my laptop as on production machines in our production environment at eBay. Structuring Puppet, this for the people who will download it and don't see the talk. Problems I've taken in account with the design, be able to share code between different platforms. Another key point is you get a new colleague and he wants to learn Puppet. He's diving into your code base and yeah, disasters will happen. Keep it as simple as possible and keep dependencies clear. I'm going to try to explain. It starts with the shared module path. It's a top-down structure. I will, in this demo, you could add more paths, but we're currently using 4 paths. The shared path, in shared path, you place modules like Tomcat, Apache, PHP, Nginx, whatever. It's definitely not allowed to put any configurations in this path. Yeah, the rule at eBay is the code should be anonymous enough to release it on the internet. So the release I did an hour ago on the internet, it's just a copy of those modules without any changes, and nobody knows it comes from eBay. Another thing, for example, if you have an LDAP module and an NACD module, if you change LDAP, you need to restart NACD module. People start hacking this dependencies into the LDAP module. Don't do it. It's a disaster. Somebody else needs NACD for some name server caching, and the fun begins. So we solve dependencies on a higher level. This is the second path, users. It's not used a lot, but because it's a top-down structure, and we want to be able to call, since we have different platforms, and we want to be able to call Puppet modules or users from the platform collections, it's there. Go to the next. This is the key, the platform modules directory. We have, for every platform, we have a base system. It's one module, which uses the zone location system. It configures actually 95% of the stuff you need to do on the machine. Yeah, if you look to our base module, it's really big. And all the pain, DNS, DHCP, you're sure, you roll out the machine and you're sure it's working. Then the only thing you have to do, and we at eBay use most of the time machines for only one purpose, is configuring the Tomcat or adding the Java thing or the Hadoop cluster or whatever. Again, platform is allowed to include users, and it's allowed to include users or modules from shared. So the NACD LDAP problem, I will solve it at the platform level. Since Puppet 2.6, it's really easy to put those dependencies in place. And then we have the wrong button. Then we have the last path, configs, and this is where all the magic happens. This is where you configure node classes or node collections. I was talking about a new colleague who wants to dive into Puppet. With this path, he can create his own full Puppet setup without having to go in the platform users or shared modules, because it's isolated. Another nice thing of this structure is some people are only allowed to commit or actually to release code from the shared path. A little bit more people or all platform owners are allowed to release code in the platform level. And what people do in configs, I don't care. My timer goes. So let's go to the demo. Let's double check. I'm really too fast.
I've got a question.
Yeah, sure.
You mentioned that you solve dependencies at a higher level.
Yes.
Like what, where, how do you abstract those?
I will show some code. That's the easiest way. Better. Yeah. Next time, get a better beamer, please. let's find an example. Should be one. I stripped out the LDAP stuff. Okay, let's find another example. Okay, here are a few examples. Let's change the color scheme. For example, we have the class logstash, and it needs we have the service syslog-ng. As soon as something changes in the logstash class, syslog next generation should restart. So this is the way how you solve it above. This is a pretty easy example for the demo, and Puppet Lab should change this. To be able to do the demo, this is one. This is the most extreme dependency rule you could create because it does really everything. Let's show it. Okay, what did we roll out in about 15 minutes? For me, it's smoking 2 cigarettes. We have the Puppet dashboard. I really like it. I don't care about the dashboard, but the thing, the inventory servers, it's probably much better already than 95% of all CMDB systems. The information which is here is right. Pretty nice, automatically configured. Hell to configure, but I decided to do it. All our Puppet code is documented. Let's see if we can find. Nice one. We have authors by the. We put authors by the module, so if somebody else uses it and has questions, people know to ask the questions. We use parameter documentation and some more. That's what we created. Let's start the fun part. And run Puppet on the Overlord. Syncs the code. It's running Puppet, and we need to realize the exported resources. Ta-da. If we now go back to the other stuff we configured, Logstash, it's a nice competitor for Splunk, I think. We have centralized logging of all our systems. We have configured ActiveMQ automatically, and if you look inside it, we have mCollective. That's one of the things I recommend to orchestrate your infrastructure. We have Camel, not that interesting. We have a PHP MyAdmin. I only use it to lock up browse the Puppet stored configs database. We have a PowerDNS status page, we have an Nginx status page, we have an SNMP server or SNMP configured, we have an NTP server, we have a PostFix server, and the coolest part, we have Nigels. And we have automatically monitored our infrastructure. That's not everything. We have Moonin and Moonin should run. Let's force Moonin run. Oh, it's already running. It should be running. Let's come back in a moment. We have seedbank documentation. I don't think it's complete, but lots of stuff has been documented. Quick start guide, how to set up seedbank. My colleagues Lex van Roon did a great job with start of documenting infrastructure anywhere. How do you set up your repository? How do you install the third KVM properly? Let's try the Moonin thing once again. Here it is. We have Moonin with a few hundred graphs. For Tomcat, I've written a tool. I won't open source it today, but probably in the future. And literally, we create thousands of graphs by just running one command. We have Pixie boot files in Seedbank, which is also the database backend of Seedbank. Here you can see the overlay I've chosen, and from there the Seedbank daemon knows what to do on the system. Now we have way more. The source code. Seedbank infrastructure anywhere. Most of the Puppet modules I've been using for this demo, or actually all the Puppet modules are on the internet since an hour. Don't expect to get infrastructure anywhere running in 5 minutes. It took me 6 years to get here. But I think if you really have experience, you should be able to run it in a day. If not, probably 2 weeks, but still 2 weeks against 6 years. Everything has been released in an Apache 2 license. Currently, I'm the only maintainer author of Seedbank. I don't have any idea about the future. It's in Python, it's pretty simple, so people are welcome to extend it. 2 Git repositories at GitHub, one with the Seedbank code and infrastructure anywhere in the add-ons directory. The other Git repo contains the Puppet modules with the zone location fact, which all modules use the style guide, I think high quality modules. I think there's some jewels in there. For example, the Puppet master module is the most difficult module I've ever created, it's able, if I will roll out another machine, it's called Puppet CA, and change one variable. The current Puppet master, which is running, detects there's a Puppet CA in the network. It downgrades itself, it takes the CA ability away, and it will automatically configure the central Puppet CA server. Another jewel inside, but out of the scope of this talk, is Tomcat Multi module I've created. With just default Debian packages, it's able to run multiple instances of Tomcat. I think it's the key for proper monitoring, just use a GVM for one application. Look around, infrastructureanywhere.com. The site looks flashy. It's really simple, link to the documentation, link to the GitHub page, the pre-built Debian package of Seedbank, and this presentation. Yeah, that's it.
Why did you decide to keep your common Puppet things in one big module instead of dividing it up into like a DNS client?
It's not in one big module. It's divided. Currently, we use one Git repo. And I'm still hoping every module should be in their own Git submodule. One of the reasons is, I think developers, we have lots of custom applications. When I started working for eBay, I get a wiki page with the changes described. I don't have a clue what the changes are. I make typos. So the ideal world will be you give the developer access to that specific Git module. He uploads his configuration changes. You do a Git diff, looks fine, and you release it on production. But everything is separated. But it's used as one. All modules are isolated. But together it will give the opportunity to do stuff like this. But if you look to the shared module path, everybody could use it without having any other needs or relations to other modules. More questions?
Do you have any plans
Maybe with my next job, but yeah, currently we're running a few thousands of Debian machines. It shouldn't be too difficult. I've been running Red Hat systems in the past. If you look at the infrastructure anywhere, yeah, just use Kickstarter for it. It should be doable, but yeah, there are only 24 hours in a day, so for now, no. More questions? Yes, of course. Yeah, yeah. I don't know how much. Yeah, I don't even have Twitter account. I don't know. It's on GitHub. So if people, I want to keep it simple. I've been a maintainer or I've been a committer to Cobbler. I did it for 2 weeks. Try to add the Debian support there. It's a nice product, but they lost the core of a Unix system, small parts which you connect together. But yeah. Patches are welcome, and I'm happy to apply those. For the Puppet modules, I think this is it for now. Maybe next year we will add improved modules. But yeah, it's too much hassle. But I think what's there, it's the first in the world in this way. So yes. No, you were in the seedbank. You run this command, and it looks if the pixie file is there. If it's not, it creates one. If it's there, it will override it. And from there, as soon as you boot the machine, and we have pixie booting out, or actually we use installation VLAN. But as soon as you boot the machine, it will read this file. As soon as the installation is done, the seedbank daemon will disable the file.
So it creates a MAC address based config file?
Yeah, it's one of the options, or a CMDB connection, or IP address based file. Yes, it's all options which are possible. I've integrated into it. First, I build it home for my own projects, and then you go live, and this one needs to be done by a MAC address, this needs to be done by something else. But all the options are there. But it's just a real simple command line tool. And the end result, people could develop seedbank for years, but the end result will be the same. It's the cleanest way to install a Debian machine. Even the traces, when you run a Puppet manifest or choose it, it will be erased after the first boot. And it's exactly the same thing as you put the CD inside. And I think that's the most tested part of an OS. Is that clear? Thank you. More questions? Nope. Okay, then I want to say thanks to a few people. Unfortunately, I started in the Windows world. I didn't like it, but I couldn't sell myself. There are some people that had lots of patience for me, or helped me, or supported me, or thought I was better than I ever wished. Roald Zijlstra, GJ Moot, Danny van der Meulen, Armand Verstappen, and especially also Lex van Roon. I did the proof of concept of Infrastructure Anywhere. He went wild and he started the born of a new application. I don't know where it goes. Okay, let's get wasted.
A fitting closer. All right, guys, so we'll see you at 7 o'clock over at, that place where we play video games. Thanks, everybody. We'll see you tomorrow.